So good morning in this second day of the conference on of quantum foundations. So we have today the pleasure of the first talk by Omar Osenda, who is from Universidad Nacional de Córdoba in Argentina. He will speak about the use of optimization methods for quantum mechanics problems. So go on, please, Omar.
Okay, thank you, Mariela. Well, congratulations to all the organizers for finally that the 10th edition of this conference finally has is taking place, and thank you for the opportunity to address the some colleagues in these times. Actually, I usually prepare too much material for a talk, so I have planned this talk in two parts. I don't know how I will use exactly the time, but depending on how much time and how fast I can go, I will cover the transmission of quantum states and maybe something of about few body problems, but mainly the talk is about the transmission of quantum states. Usually, when this work is not published yet, you can find it in the archive. But it's an ongoing collaboration with Pablo Serra and Alejandro Ferrón. And well, we can start thinking what is exactly a quantum state transfer, what we can think a quantum channel is made of. 15 years ago, talking about a change of quantum systems, replicas of quantum systems that are interacting between them, and that can be used as a wire to transmit information. Well, 15 years ago, this was mainly a dream. It was the realm of theoretical physics. Today, there are a lot of technical advances that made the transmission of quantum state possible. In solid state implementation, that is the setting that many people think about. In quantum state implementations, for example, the wire that will transmit the quantum state could be, for example, a chain of quantum dots or a chain of superconducting qubits, etc. Ideally, the wire is used to transmit quantum information from a sender to a receiver. Okay, the sender ideally will prepare some quantum state, that is the information that want to send. The channel should be initialized to a simple state, and the receiver will perform some measurements to retrieve the information that the sender sent to him. Okay, so obviously this is a quite complicated problem if the Hamiltonian of the system is a many body Hamiltonian, and the interaction are long range, etc. So most people think usually in very simple systems, in particular many times the problem is not solved in the whole Hilbert space. So usually the Hamiltonian has some symmetries, some that allow to restrict the dynamic of the problem to a reduced Hilbert space, to a subspace, a subspace of the whole Hilbert space. There are many protocols. A protocol is a recipe to prepare the state, the how the system evolves in time, and finally how the information is retrieved at the other extreme of the chain. Okay, so many people is familiarized with the XX Hamiltonian, that is a spin Hamiltonian that has only interaction, for example, in the plane, is an anisotropic Hamiltonian. And to fix idea, many people think that the initial state is prepared in the first side of the channel. The rest of the chain is initialized in a zero state that, depending on the physics of the problem, is maybe the the ground state of the system. And the time evolution obviously is produced for some with some unitary time evolution operator, okay? Because at least in principle, the simplest way to analyze these problems is using unitary time evolution. Obviously, it is possible to consider an open chain, an open quantum system, but the problem becomes almost intractable. At least if the length of the chain will be around the tens of spins or things like that. Well, this is just to fix ideas. There are many forms, many protocols, but this is the simplest. An initial state, and in the simplest protocol, the time evolution is given by the autonomous Hamiltonian of the chain. There is not external forces, so the time evolution is the simplest time evolution operator, is the exponential of the Hamiltonian. Okay, it is possible to use the spectral decomposition of the operator. A lot of things are easy to calculate. Even more, if this is the initial state and the Hamiltonian is ferromagnetic and the zero state is the ground state, this Hamiltonian commutes with the total magnetization, so the dynamics is restricted to the one excitation subspace, so the dimension of the actual Hilbert space is basically the size of the chain. If the chain has n spins, then the dimension of the Hilbert space in the one excitation subspace, the dimension of the Hilbert space, the subspace is just n. So. Okay, many times the quantity that is used to quantify how successful is the protocol is called the fidelity, the transmission fidelity, that can be calculated rather easily with using the amplitude probability that the that an excitation is transferred from the first side of the chain to the last side of the chain. This quantity is quite easy to calculate, in the sense that it's just an expectation value of the time evolution operator. Okay, this particular formula can be deduced because to qualify the channel, usually what is used is an average over the whole initial state, over all the initial state that can be prepared. Okay, just to fix some ideas, many times the well, it is interesting to consider that the chain could be in a disorder state. The couplings maybe cannot be fixed to some desired value. Maybe there are defects in the fabrication process, or just like every nanostructural system, it is quite difficult to fix all the couplings, etc. And this is, for example, how it is possible, for example, to control the time evolution of the problem. Sometimes it is useful just to consider that the transmission process is forced or controlled by applying some external control functions. Why? Because many times the natural time evolution, the autonomous time evolution, is not sufficient to achieve a good transmission. Obviously, the idea is that if the fidelity reaches the unity, well, the transmission is perfect. All values of FT superior to 0.999 are considered interesting, but obviously, depending on the Hamiltonian, how this exchange coupling coefficients are chosen, etc., this fidelity could be a fiber that is rather lower than the unit. So it is useful sometimes to consider a force evolution. But the problem of the force evolution is obviously controlling a nanoscopic, a microscopic quantum system is quite difficult. Many times it is impossible to control the system with smooth functions. There are a lot of considerations that can be made, advising against using control evolution. Many times it's the only option because the interactions cannot be chosen, but are fixed for some fundamental interaction, but the force or the control evolution of a quantum system is quite difficult. In particular, if the system doesn't have a lot of symmetries, or the dynamics cannot be kept in a subspace, it is quite difficult to calculate this control evolution, because obviously the control functions shall be obtained using an optimization method. Okay, so anyway, for the XX Hamiltonian, the people has been working in this area for many years. So there is a lot of interesting results, like perfect quantum state transmission is achievable, choosing particular values for the quantities ji, for these quantities, choosing some very particular values, it is possible to achieve using autonomous time evolution. It is possible to achieve perfect quantum state transmission, basically for any initial state. Even more, it can be proved that the dynamics behaves like a inversion, a specular inversion in the quantum chain. So the thing that you prepare in a half of the chain, it will be reflected at some time in the other half of the chain. It's a very interesting. There are regimes where almost perfect quantum state transmission can be achieved just using an almost homogeneous quantum state. All the coefficients, all the strange coefficients are equal, except a pair or maybe four exchange coupling coefficients could be chosen different, and a very, very good quantum strain transmission can be achieved. Okay, so why the XXX Hamiltonian was studied so intensively? Why there are so many results? Basically, because this fundamental fact. It's quite easy to go in the XXX Hamiltonian from a given, I can choose the couplings and I can calculate it is possible to calculate the spectrum of the system, or it is possible to prescribe the spectrum that I want to have for some Hamiltonian, and there is a unique way to calculate the exchange coupling distribution, in this case, at least in the case where we are dealing with the one excitation subspace, is a one-to-one relationship. Okay, I can prescribe, for example, a very simple spectrum. For example, I can choose that the spectrum of the system consists in n eigenvalues that can be chosen. They are equispaced between them. Okay, that sounds like a system that is quite possible to that the all contribution from the eigenvalues can add constructively at some time. So I can choose this this spectrum, and the coefficients can be calculated one by one in a unique way. Obviously, most quantum spin chains doesn't have this property. In particular, the Heisenberg Hamiltonian doesn't have this property. It is impossible to prescribe a spectrum, and in that way obtain the coefficients that produce that spectrum. Okay. As anybody that has found sometimes the Bethe ansatz, the relationship between the spectrum in the Heisenberg Hamiltonian is rather obscure. Or more precisely, because of this, many words focus in the control transmission in the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, because a lot of people thought that it was easier to control the a quantum chain, an homogeneous quantum chain obeying the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, and designing very sophisticated control pulses. Can be found that maybe the transmission time was the time in which the receiver can retrieve the information sent by the sender. That time is around, obviously, if j is equal to one, there are almost no energy units, no, so it is natural to to measure the transmission time in units of the length of the chain. That is the only characteristic length. Okay, if J is exactly equal to one, this is a very good unit to measure the time. I didn't say it, but another interesting quantity or another interesting feature of the change with the excess Hamiltonian is that here it is rather easy to show that the transmission time, the time that the receiver should wait to measure and obtain a very good fidelity of transmission, that time is bounded by the time that is consistent with the quantum speed limit. So it is rather easy to think that this Hamiltonian has a sound velocity for the spin waves, and that velocity is related to the quantum speed limit. In the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, there is no simple way to assess which is the time scale in which convenient to measure or to try to produce a very good transmission. Okay, so what can be done with all this? Well, actually, we said that that this quantity, the probability that an excitation can be transmitted from the first side to the last side, is a quantity that depends on the spectrum and on the some coefficients of the eigenvector. So this quantity can be optimized. Okay, I can think that this is a complicated function that depends, obviously, on all the coefficients, you know, all the same coefficients that determine the Hamiltonian. So maybe I can choose somehow the exchange couplings, and using that exchange coupling, I can calculate the spectrum, the eigenvalues, and calculate this. So if I can devise a method to explore a large number of values of the J coefficients, maybe I can find the largest value for this quantity for some time that I can choose somehow. Okay, so it is obvious that this function, the amplitude of probability that an excitation goes from the first side to the last side, is a quantity that depends on all the coefficients. In a general change, there will be n J coefficients, n exchange coefficients. So for a chain, for example, of 50 spins, it is a rather large space, parameter space, to explore. So it is hopeless to try to investigate the whole whole space in a completely random way. A space of 50 dimensions is too big to explore. So maybe the exploration can be done using some kind of random walk, but it must be a directed random walk in the parameter space. Okay. Well, fortunately, there are a lot of I don't know if many, but the people in the statistical mechanics area has devised a lot of methods to explore rather large parameter space, and one of these methods are the pivot methods that are used for global optimization. So pivot methods are basically a good way to generate a random walk that explores in an intelligent way a given parameter space. Obviously, this is an example, an abstract example of a search conducted over a two-dimensional parameter space. This is a typical typical chart flow that can be found in all the papers in pivot methods are paper from the 90s. So instead of using some colorful cartoons, it's most common to find chart flows like this, because chart flow were the way to express an algorithm. Okay, I don't want to enter, but I mean any pivot method, any method can be used to say that is useful to search in a large parameter space. It can be used to perform exactly the same that we did. So, for example,
excuse me, you have 10 more minutes, so yep. To finish everything.
Thank you. This is, for example, how can a search for the coefficients can be done. This is a short chain, but is useful because the chains that are used are termed centrosymmetric, because there are symmetry between the first exchange coefficient and the last, and the optimization method proceeds, the pivot method proceeds like by looking in a particular hypercube that contains all the possible values of the exchange coefficients. The problem with the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, as there is not, and believe me, there is not a simple way to bound the values that I of the exchange coefficient that I need to use to achieve the transmission for some time, because again the spectrum is quite complicated. We proceeded by looking at the best possible values of J that provided a very good or the best fidelity of transmission in a small hypercube. But then we proceed to enlarge the hypercube, and we go from some exchange coupling distributions that are obtained using some particular transmission time, and this is what we found after a lot of numerical effort, that effectively we can found a very good near perfect quantum state transmission for spin chains of basically the length that we wanted, and for the arrival times that of our choosing. Okay, so the pivot method is able to find the necessary exchange couplings to produce very good or near perfect quantum state transmission in the Heisenberg Hamiltonian. That is a result that was not known previously, but obviously it is the way to look for this exchange coupling is clearly is the result of a random walk that is performed. It's a direct random walk, but maybe we can think that well, the probability of transmission is quite high. It's quite interesting. If you look at in this inset, all the transmission probabilities can be made. Well, basically, are bigger than 0.999. If we want to that kind, that quality of transmission. But obviously, once we get the exchange coupling distribution, we wanted to understand if the solutions, this solution has some physics in them, or are just results that the only thing that can be said about them is that they provide a very good quantum state transmission. So we looked for the probability, for the probability of having a good transmission. This is a typical time evolution near the transmission time. These are the peaks of the probability for different settings. We can design or use different arrival times. So, for example, these are very short arrival times. The black curves, the red curves correspond to a larger arrival time. The blue one, a more larger arrival time. But each one of these was calculated with a different exchange coupling distribution. But some of us have a strong background in scaling and that kind of property. So we scale the time evolution of the probability, and we found that basically it doesn't matter what is the time, the arrival time. Basically, the time behavior around the arrival time is basically the same, which is a quite neat result, because the exchange coefficients that are used to calculate the probability of the arrival probability for a given time has nothing to do with the another exchange coupling distribution. So, for example, it's possible to after some numerical experiments are done, it is possible to study what is the minimum size of the aperture necessary to find where this exchange coupling can be found. This is that size. For example, we can say that if we choose larger arrival times, the strength of the exchange coupling distribution, the maximum value of the exchange coupling distribution, basically decays in an exponential way. So in a sense, we can say that for very large for very large arrival time, basically the chain will be basically almost homogeneous, but not exactly homogeneous. There is no need to have very different values between the exchange coupling distributions. Another way to qualify how good are these exchange coupling distributions, for example, consider once the exchange coupling, the set of exchange couplings has been obtained, What about Addison disorder? If well, looking at this fiber, it's quite obvious that the probability, the transmission, the transfer, the probability that is related to fidelity can be made as large as as close to the unity as wanted. But these values are stable. If some disorder is produced, everything maybe the transmission under some disorder is completely destroyed or not. Well, we consider some static disorder applied to the chain, and we found that well, the chain was able to sustain some disorder. So the in some sense the maximum found for found by the pivot method is rated well, because applying some disorder can be thought like making another stochastic search, another stochastic search around the values that the pivot method found, but basically we can say that the spin distribution are produce a very good, very good transmission, and that they are quite stable against disorder. So as I said, I prepared a lot of material, but the conclusion of this
part, we are almost in time.
The conclusion, well, the physics near this new configuration, this new change, is quite explored. We want to study the physics, how the transmission is produced in this change that has that have the couplings tailored specifically to produce a large fidelity of transmission. As a stochastic search, everything worked fine, but we don't know why. At least, well, in that moment when we wrote the manuscript, we didn't have clues why everything works so fine. I think that we now have some clues and we are exploring them. This procedure will be successfully translated to another Hamiltonians. We are looking for that. There are another procedures to determine these couplings in another way. Maybe there are looking at the exchange couplings that are calculated, it is not obvious that they can be translated in a simple formula. We're discussing also if some experimental implementation can be made. Well, and that's it. Well, half minutes,
okay.
1 minute and half larger than that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Omar. So if someone has just a short question, we can put it here. So you said mean the number of elements in mind. You study the length of the chain. You did a search. Sorry, you search with the length of the chain depending on n.
Sorry, the communication was interrupted, but I couldn't hear the question. Can you repeat? Sorry, Mariela.
If you did the search with the length of the chain, with depending on the number n, just showed some here. But you mean small, the size of the system you
No, we can study the chains from 10 spins to 100. There is not an actual limit. We stopped in 100 because we didn't want to wait for the results, but there is not a practical limit. A chain of 100 sites is clearly beyond any practical implementation, at least for mm-hmm. the few next years.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But there is no an upper bound. We stop around 100, but for some new experiments or for some new results, we are maybe looking at 120. Yeah.
Okay. So we don't have any comments. So we thank again Omar with a clap, virtual clap.
Well,
so we can change the speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, organizers. I want to thank you again. Congratulations to achieve the 10th conference. Yeah. And well, for a very good acronym.